Although language planning refers to the activity of preparing normative orthography, grammar, and dictionary of a language for the guidance of speakers in a non-homogeneous speech community, it is practiced as a systematic manipulation of language in pursuance of certain state goals. In this lecture, we'll talk about the role of language policy and planning in the spread of English. Language planning from this political perspective can be defined as the deliberate efforts to influence the behavior of users of language with respect to the acquisition, grammar, and functions that their language performs. When it comes to language planning, we have two kinds of approaches. One is the top-down approach. According to this approach, language policies are formulated by the people who are in power and authority, and then they impose these policies that they make on the users of the language, on speech communities generally. In this approach, language policy is conceived as a unidirectional process. Unidirectional in the sense that only the people who are in authority are given the responsibility of preparing these policies, determining rules and regulations for the use of the language, and also with respect to the functions that a particular language can or should perform. And the rest of the population, all the other people, the actual users of the language in the speech community, are only recipients of these policies and these rules and regulations. They simply follow these rules and regulations and policies. In this way, language policy is viewed as an instrument of social control. In this way, languages are used to control populations generally. And it is also used as a tool for the achievement of certain ideological objectives. For example, languages can be used to propagate a certain set of beliefs or certain set of values. And since they are imposed on the languages are imposed, or the language policies are imposed on different speech communities, they are also bound to come under the influence of those ideological perspectives. The theory of linguistic imperialism, which is often discussed in the context of colonialism, also falls under this top-down approach. The theory of linguistic imperialism takes for granted that the colonizing nations possess the power to impose their will on the subjugated population, and this will also includes the way a particular language can be used, or the degree of prestige or importance that can be allocated to a certain language in the area which is under their rule. Then we have a bottom-up language policy. In a bottom-up language policy approach, speech communities are not passive recipients of the policies which are formulated by the people in authority, but they are active contributors to the shaping of the language policy. Their will counts, or their personal preferences also contribute to the formulation of the language policy. So in a way, these people, the people generally, people in different speech communities, they do not only receive the policies which are formulated by the higher-ups, they co-determine the policies and the context in which those policies are implemented. And in some cases, they even seize the initiative from the authorities and sort of control the use of the language in different communities. So bottom-up language policy approach is not unilateral. In a bottom-up approach, both the authorities and the speech communities, they co-determine the policy or the rules and regulations that determine the use of a language. It is an outcome. It can be described as an outcome of this interplay, interaction between people with conflicting aims. So the authorities may want a certain language to be given more prominence, whereas the speech community generally may have a preference for a certain other language. So a language policy as a result evolves, which is this interplay between the conflicting aims and conflicting wills of the authorities and speech communities. When it comes to looking at the global spread of English, the conventional notions of language policy and planning, they do not really apply, because according to these conventional policies of language planning, it is only the people in authority who are responsible for implementing a language policy. So this top-down approach does not include any critical perspective, whereas the reality of the spread of English involves an understanding of this critical perspective of language policy and planning, where several speech communities or people who actually practice the languages have had an important role in the shaping of or in the spread of English globally. According to this conventional notion, the spread of English is attributed only to the West. And English spread, according to this perspective, English spread because the Western people used it. So English spread because people in the West used it and spread it. Whereas this is an extremely imperialistic view of the spread of English, and we need to look at the spread of English also from this perspective of bottom-up approach of language planning and policy.